treatment. And a lot of people choose treatment.
It provides no basis for speaking about addiction. Anybody who is at all sophisticated about marijuana would rate them the way two researchers were asked to rate drugs in order of addiction. Nicotine was one, alcohol was two, then heroin, then cocaine, then coffee, and then marijuana. There may have been a couple of other drugs, but marijuana was at the very bottom, below coffee.
This narcotic, unlike the opiates, the synthetics, and cocaine, is non-addictive.
What do you mean by non-addictive?
By non-addictive, it is meant that the user of marijuana, when deprived of the drug, will not experience the agonies of withdrawal. It is habituating, but its use can be discontinued.
Then what is its danger?
It's used as a scapegoat for covering up underlying problems in people, especially young people. Here I am, don't ignore me.
If you use marijuana on a daily basis for a year or so, and you stop using it, you're going to notice some differences, but nothing like the kind of withdrawal people will experience in withdrawing from either tobacco or heroin.
But why would the government and the DEA want to put a statistic like that out there? We'll learn more about that later. The gateway theory.
Is marijuana a gateway drug?
Yes, I think it is.
Yeah, but
I don't exactly know why, but I know it is.
It opens a doorway to other drugs.
It makes you want to experience more.
It makes you feel good.
Yeah.
People want to experience something else and, you know, have a, I guess, more dreams.
Its greatest danger lies in the fact that it is a stepping stone to the harder drugs, such as morphine and heroin.
That's why there are people that want to legalize marijuana. They figure if they can get the young people in this country onto hard drugs, they can destroy your generation, or in this generation.
You know, in the days of Harry Anslinger, it was called the stepping stone hypothesis. If you stepped on this stone, marijuana, you were bound and determined to go on to the next stone, which would be one of the so-called hard drugs.
Every time it's been studied and looked at and so on, they have never, ever found that there's certainly nothing in marijuana that makes you want to go to anything else.
There is no inherent psychopharmacological property of the drug which pushes one toward another drug.
I'll smoke a joint. I want a bag of chips and fucking junk food. I don't want to go out and get ripped.
I drink alcohol. That's my drug of choice. It could be said I started on milk. I mean, this is crazy. If I use marijuana, why does that automatically make me a candidate to black tar heroin? It's a nonsensical argument.
In fact, only one out of every 104 marijuana users use cocaine, and less than one use heroin.
The black market throws the dealers of soft drugs together with the dealer of hard drugs.
So if you have a black market, and you have a dealer that's dealing in marijuana and LSD and everything else, and the dealer might say to you, hey, you want to try something stronger? Well, in that sense, because of the black market, because of prohibition, people may be more susceptible to seeing these other drugs and being willing to try these other drugs.
And so what you see is that there is a gateway effect, but it's a gateway effect caused by prohibition and the blending of the hard and soft drug markets.
Where does this leave us? Oh, wait. What about laziness? You will be useless to society if you use marijuana. But if that's true, well, there are about 50 million people who smoke marijuana in America and over half of the Canadian population who've tried it. And yet, both societies seem to flourish. And just look who some of these people are.
Steve Jobs developed Apple computers smoking pot. Ted Turner developed CNN News smoking pot. Still smokes a joint every day. You go through every musician you like, from the Rolling Stones to the Beatles to Led Zeppelin, they all smoke pot.
Snoop Dogg, Willie Nelson.
Come on, Bill Clinton, don't be so naive.
Virtually every presidential candidate has now copped to using marijuana at some time in his or her life.
A few times in the Army, I tried marijuana. It was not a significant part of my life.
I had a senior law enforcement official tell me that in his judgment, up to a quarter of the White House staff when they first came in had used drugs in the last 4 or 5 years.
The people that have personality problems and the people that are going to be lazy and going to lose their job, they're going to lose their job anyway. They're not losing their job because of marijuana. That's just a lie.
I love Tommy Chong. I think that a lot of the Cheech and Chong episodes that people believed, not knowing that Tommy wrote and directed the movies, thinking that, you know, that's what a stupid stoner looks like. No, actually, that's what a really brilliant creative genius looks like, acting like somebody you think's a stoner.
And none of this is borne out in the research or when you look at people who are long-term users and are, happen to be lawyers, judges, doctors, and, you know, writers.
But what about the potency of the drug?
Marijuana is dangerous. There's higher THC levels than ever before.
Anytime you got a bag of Colombian dope 20 years ago, it was way better than the Mexican swag that you normally got. So there's always been a range of THC in plants, and the fact that we can now grow stuff that's equivalent of what Colombian was 20 years, well, it doesn't mean that we're boosting THC to unheard-of levels. It just means, you know, hi, there are some nuances in this discussion that people should be aware of.
And I actually think that it's a real stroke of our own ego to think that for the 50 or so years of prohibition that we've improved upon varieties that have been cultivated for drug use in places like India and such for thousands of years.
People say, well, you can abuse marijuana. Well, shit, you can abuse cheeseburgers too. You know, you don't go around closing Burger King because you can abuse something. I can take a fucking fork and jam it in my eyeballs. That mean forks should be illegal? You know, I could jump off a bridge. Should we outlaw bridges? Let's nerf the world.
But what about all the crime and violence associated with marijuana?
From beat cop to police chief, I saw ample evidence of the harm caused by alcohol and the absence of evidence caused by marijuana use. And I mean the complete absence. I cannot recall a single case in which marijuana contributed to domestic violence, crimes of theft, and the like.
You want to know what a weed smoker looks like? You're staring at one. You know, like, I'm a weed smoker. I'm not, like, crazy or, you know, I'm not stabbing you right now.
Most of the violent crime that's committed, or most of the crime period that's committed to having to do with drugs, is people who are on drugs committing violent crimes. If you make it legal, if you make it cheaper, you make it more available, you're going to have more violence, more
Tom,
addiction,
that is
more
not
crime.
True. Stop lying to us.
Oh, now, come on.
Stop lying to us. That is not true. You know, don't tell me that. I've smoked pot, Tom.
But
I've admitted it. I've done it. I've done all of the big three. I've done tobacco, I've done alcohol, and I've done marijuana, Tom. Guess what? Marijuana's the least of the three, pal.
You guys proved me wrong or whatever? I want to hear someone that has smoked too much weed and went home and beat his wife and beat his children or whatever, like you see on booze.
The only big issue on alcohol is drunken driving and binge drinking among college students. Otherwise, you can drink to your heart's content.
There are far more crimes committed under the influence of unadulterated, if you will, emotions. Anger, rage, jealousy.
A lot of our understanding is driven by what's in the paper and on the television and the radio these days. And we get extremes and the black and white thinking is reinforced, I think, by that.
If only there is something to compare it to. Something that was prohibited at one time but is now regulated. So we could see what the difference might be. What could that be? What could that be?
Under prohibition of alcohol, everything got worse. Everything.
Alcohol prohibition really birthed and gave rise to massive organized criminal groups within the United States. It led to a general disregard for the law and a general disregard for police activity because it was a law that most people didn't obey.
Would you have supported the prohibition of alcohol 75 years ago?
Well, I'm glad you brought up the alcohol example. I mean, as a governor, you must have known firsthand the cost of alcohol. I hear this argument a lot of times, like alcohol...
That isn't what I asked you, Tom. I asked you a specific question. Don't give me spin.
I said, would you have
supported the prohibition of alcohol 75 years ago?
I don't think I would have.
Why?
Because alcohol, for better or worse, and a lot of times for worse, it's a close call, is a long entrenched and ingrained part of our culture and our society. I mean, you go back thousands of years, the first writing is about alcohol, the Bible, everything else. It's really hard to reach
well,
in
Tom, wait
and
a
pull
minute.
This out of
Let
society.
Let me inject something then if you okay. believe that God also made the marijuana
I'm talking
plant,
about society. I'm talking about our
wait,
culture and our society.
You just said the Bible.
Alcohol poisoning went up by 600% during Prohibition. There were more speakeasies in large cities like New York City under Prohibition than there are taverns and liquor stores today.
Sure, one can point to alcohol as being a continuing social problem, but we don't have people shooting each other over alcohol.
When alcohol was prohibited, people lived at that time to know the difference between prohibition and non-prohibition. They could see that the prohibition of alcohol caused the emergence of gangsters in the underworld that took control of these substances. Alcohol then was no longer in their control.
Could this be the same for marijuana?
It strengthens organized crime, without a doubt, because you have to be a criminal to sell it. It's that simple.
This brings crime into it. That's why the benefits and the ability to make money is so huge in it.
Weapons were used to intimidate people, and we've seized approximately 50 weapons, sawed-off shotguns, and most of them are loaded.
Where's all this competition we've heard so much about? You call these prices low?
Marijuana is just a weed, and marijuana is worth more ounce for ounce than gold.
You don't find legal commodities, you know, at $200 an ounce. You don't even find them at $200 a pound. Heck, most things are $200 a ton for corn and grain and barley.
That's why when you walk 10 pounds of marijuana across the border into the United States, it becomes worth 20 pounds.
You create an artificially inflated value for that drug that is so huge that people decide it's worth murdering people in order to control this market.
I think the Fraser Institute called cannabis prohibition a gift of revenue to organized crime.
But what do growers and dealers think of this?
Would you like to see the government in the future legalize marijuana here in BC?
Stealing money from us?
I know I wouldn't like to see it legalized. The government would control and regulate the product, and that could potentially hurt a lot of people in the industry.
How can you compete with factories that have perfectly rolled out doobies, then perfect it, and we'd all be out of money?
It makes for strange bedfellows. You've got the police and the high-level drug dealers both agreeing that we should maintain this prohibition. Well, when you got high-level drug dealers saying prohibition is good, you might want to scratch your head a little and think, well, shoot, why would they want to continue prohibition?
I can't imagine why a grower who's making $150,000 or $300,000 a year would ever want to see marijuana legalized. I mean, the last thing a grower wants is sensible policy. The madness continues and they continue to get rich.
You know, Betty, I'm going to bring this up at the business meeting tomorrow.
You make the penalty stiffer? You know what? Good. For those people who are not getting caught, price goes up.
See, so not only do we allow them to tell us how much drugs are going to be supplied, the potency of those drugs, who they're going to sell to, where they're going to sell them, just to make sure they get it all right, we let them keep all the profits.
So you've got essentially a Wild West. You've got an unregulated market in which anything can happen. It certainly may work for things that people generally accept, but if you try to prohibit something that's in demand, that the people want, then it's pure folly.
And without control, it's hard to regulate areas of concern, like keeping it out of the hands of our children. There have been some studies that suggest heavy sustained long-term use from adolescence to adulthood has the potential to exacerbate symptoms of those with a genetic predisposition for schizophrenia. And although there is strong evidence that refutes this, it does lead one to question. Could there be a better way of deterring children from using, rather than letting dealers decide what age is appropriate?
For the last 10 years, our children across the United States have said that it's easier to buy illegal drugs than it is to buy beer and cigarettes.
It's harder to get beer because you have to go through a regulated establishment that's going to check ID, that's going to have those safeguards in place, that isn't just going to sell it to you because you got 40 bucks in your pocket.
Guy down on the street corner, he doesn't want to know how old they are. He don't want to see an ID. He says, show me the money. And if they get the money, it doesn't matter if that child is 4 years old, they're going to get the dope.
If you can't control the sale of the product, how on earth are you going to keep it out of the hands of kids?
Could we be the creators of what we now see as some of our biggest problems? Have our solutions been prelude to our worst fears?
Yeah, the use of the criminal law for the basis of public health is a wholly bad idea, no matter how you cut it.
It doesn't work. You cannot legislate morality.
One person can say it's immoral to legalize it just as much as someone can say it's immoral not to legalize it. It doesn't get you anywhere. You have to have a rational policy debate by talking about the consequences.
Now, I've had young people tell me that, well,
Your generation had a martini and that was your crutch, and why can't we have our own kind of crutch? You know what?